Hello all, welcome back to my YouTube channel. In today's video, I'll be talking about an interesting topic, how production support model works. So I got a request from a couple of my subscribers asking me to create a video on this topic. Okay, so let me get into the details. So the production team comes into picture after go live. So go live could be anything. It could be go live of a simple customization or a custom report, or could be a complex project like which is upgrading of a Oracle application from say 11i to R12, or moving from release 12 to say Fusion and so on, or totally implementing of a new Oracle application system from the legacy system. So go implementation team takes care of the go live activities. And after the go live, or maybe 1 or 2 weeks before the go live, it is the responsibility of implementation team to give the KT, that is knowledge transfer, to the production support team. So in most of the cases, whatever I've seen, generally the implementation team and production support team will be different. Again, it could be a different team within the same vendor, or it could be totally two different vendors as well. So maybe implementation team could be a Deloitte vendor, and a production support team could be TCS or Wipro or some other vendor. So the first phase after go live is hypercare period. So again, depending on the complexity of the project, hypercare period can vary from say 1 week to say 4 weeks or 6 weeks. So hypercare period is the period immediately after the go live, wherein implementation team will be readily available to resolve any issues. So during the hypercare period, for any issues which are raised by the users, implementation team will be responsible, and production support team will be just shadowing the implementation team to understand the issues. And after the hypercare period, maybe for 1 or 2 weeks after the hypercare period, the production support team owns the issues. They take the responsibility of resolving the issues, but if required, they can take the help of the implementation team. And after that, it gets into something called regular production support, wherein production support team takes the complete responsibility of all the issues, and the implementation team moves on. So if it's a different vendor, they will not be even available. So it will be the complete responsibility of the production support team to take care of all the issues. So now with regard to how the support model works. So the first thing is, whenever a user has an issues, he raises a ticket in the ticketing tool. And depending on the urgency of the issues, he assigns a priority to the ticket. It could be P1, P2, P3, and so on. So as much information as possible, he's going to mention that in the ticket. It could be a screenshot, or it could be a description of the issue, whatever he's facing. And as soon as the ticket is created in the ticketing tool, an auto-generated email goes to the concerned support team saying that the ticket is raised. And as far as the ticketing tools are concerned, there are a lot of tools which are available in the market. And some of the tools which I've seen in my clients is ServiceNow, Jira, Zendesk, and so on. And once the auto-generated email goes to the concerned support team, who are located either at offshore or on-site client location, they start looking at the details provided in the tickets. And if the information is not sufficient to analyze the issue or to resolve the issue, they reach out to the user over chat or email or to a phone call, or they can also do a Zoom meeting with the user. Generally, most of the clients follow something called ITIL process, Information Technology Infrastructure Library process, as far as the support issues are concerned. So as per ITIL process, we have something called incident management and problem management. So as far as the incident management is concerned, the concerned support person should provide a workaround to the user as soon as the ticket is created. So the workaround is kind of a temporary fix or resolution to the user. And a permanent fix could be a patch, or it could be a code fix. And permanent fix will be provided via something called problem ticket. So whenever the user raises an issue, it will be an incident ticket, and it will be the responsibility of the support person who is handling that particular ticket to provide a workaround to the user and then close the incident ticket and raise the problem ticket for permanent fix of that particular issue. And as far as the tickets are concerned, we have something called SLA. SLA stands for service level agreement. So for each of the the ticket, depending on the priority, there is the different service level agreement. So this SLAs or service level agreement is between the vendor who is providing the support services to the client as well as the client. It's an agreement between the client and the vendor. So for one of the client which have worked in the past, so these are a couple of SLA agreements. So if it's a priority one ticket, the response time is 15 minutes, resolution time is 8 hours. And if it's a P2 ticket, the response time is 30 minutes and resolution time is 3 business days. If it is a P3 ticket, the response time is 1 hour and resolution time is 5 business days. So when I say response time is the time within which the support team member should acknowledge the ticket. If a P1 ticket is raised, he should acknowledge the ticket is being raised and he start looking into that ticket within 15 minutes. If it's a P2, he should acknowledge that in 30 minutes. And if it's a P3, he should acknowledge that within 1 hour. And as far as the resolution is concerned, that is providing of a fix to the user. It could be a workaround. It may not be a permanent fix. It could be a workaround. And that should be 8 hours for P1 ticket. It's 3 business days for P2 ticket and 5 business days for P3 ticket. Again, this all depends on the different business requirement, or it all depends on the agreement between the vendor and the client. These are not like hard and fast rules that that the same SLAs are being followed by different clients. Okay. Now coming to the instant strategy. In any support project, we have 3 environments. Development environment, UAT environment, and production environment. So again, for one of the client where I was working, that development environment gets refreshed once in every 2 months from production environment. And my UAT environment gets refreshed from production once in every 3 months. And whenever these environments are being refreshed, so DBS has got a lot of checklist of items to be taken care of. So some of the critical things are basically mask the HR or payroll data and munch the email ID. So when I say munching of the email IDs, it's basically, say, let us assume my email ID is vrwin@xyz.com. What they do is, as part of the munching process, this is how all the email IDs in the system are being updated. vrwin@xyz.com/x. So that way, even if somebody runs any program which sends an email to the user, the email will not be actually sent to the user because the email ID is not proper. It's actually suffixed with X. I mean, there are 2 ways to handle this. One is like you can just turn off the emailing service in the development environment or UAT environment. We do not want to do that because if for some specific reason, if you want to test any emailing program, then turning off that will not help the concerned developer to perform the testing of that. So that's the reason why we follow this munching process, and only for those programs wherein user want to test, he manually removes X after the email ID and then he continues his testing. Yeah, so this is how the support model works. In my next video, I'll explain about how the change management process works. Thank you. Thanks for watching my video. For interesting videos on Oracle Financials, please do subscribe to my channel. Thank you.